the qualification round for RHME3 is over, so we can have a look now at the challenges you had to solve to qualify. I really enjoyed the exploitation challenge because it was pretty straightforward, and you have had a good chance to solve it yourself if you are familiar with my exploitation videos. So let's check it out. The binary is running on pwnable.rhme3.com. Analyze it and find a way to compromise the server. You will find the flag in the file system. When you try to access this domain via the browser, it doesn't work, but we are given two files and I'm sure we can reverse engineer the binary to figure out how to interact with the server. The fact that they give you a libc is already a good hint. Let me tell you what I think when I see it. First, the target system will be a typical modern Linux system, so no executable stack or heap, and thus we have to do rob or return to libc. And in order to do that successfully, you have to know where the rob gadgets or libc functions are. But if you use your local libc, then the offsets are probably different. Some CTFs don't give you a libc. This means it's harder because first you have to somehow leak the server libc or guess it based on addresses you leak. But yeah. And a typical exploit for a CTF challenge is to simply call the libc function system with binsh as a parameter to get a shell. So I already expect that I probably want to override some entry in the global offset table and point it to system. This means I'm kinda looking at this challenge from the reverse. I know, or at least guess, what I want to do, and to achieve this I'm looking for a way to write into the global offset table, or override some other function pointer for that matter. Only if after a while I realize that that attempt would fail, I consider other possible techniques. So let's have a look at the binaries. The main L file is not stripped, which means it will have all the symbol names in there, which makes reversing really easy. But when we try to execute it, it doesn't seem to work. And I saw some people complain that it doesn't work. But what does doesn't work mean? That's one of my pet peeves. We have to be more careful with our observations. We don't see any obvious errors. So for example, if I just rip out the start of the binary and try to execute that, I get very obvious execution errors. That's not what we see. So we have to investigate why it immediately exits. Really good tools to get a general first impression of what is happening is strace and ltrace. And when you run the binary with it, you first of all see that it does in fact run. So it works. It just exits for some reason. Ltrace will show you all the library calls, so you can see it executes get pwnnum before exiting. And the man page tells us that it tries to get the information about a user from etc pass wd, and the user was pwn, pwn. So I guess it expects this user to be there. Let's add this user. Oh, and also a good idea is to switch now to root, because it looks like the binary wants to mess with user permissions. So we add this user and there's some random info, there we go. When we now execute it, we get further. This time it builds a path, and this path obviously doesn't exist, so let's maybe create that one as well, maybe it wants that path. One other thing that happens is the fork, and fork means it creates a new process. So we should use the -f flag to follow also any child processes. Aha! And now it tries to create a socket and open a port 1337. Also, we can now connect to this port and interact with the program. And that is also the port for the remote server. I heard several people patch the binary to get around all these checks, but it's not necessary. The program just expects certain things about the environment. But whatever, your solution worked too. So now that we can see what the child process calls with ltrace, we can explore the functionality and at the same time see the libc calls. This is super helpful to maybe even find issues. Anyway, as you can see, this program is a team manager where you can add players, remove players, edit a player, or show the whole team. So I obviously started by adding a player and entered a format string as the name to check if it's a format string vulnerability, but it was not. All outputs probably printed. But I still quickly found the bug, because I noticed I first have to select a player before I can show this player. And when I do this and then delete the player I selected, I can still show the player. And now the values are weird. So obviously when you delete the player you have selected, you shouldn't be able to show the player anymore. This means we have a classical use after free condition. A reference to the deleted player was not removed. Next, I want to see how the heap looks like when we are creating players. Basically, I want to know what the player structure is. But before we get there, let's open a binary in a disassembler. You will immediately notice that the binary contains all symbols, because it was not stripped. So that is really nice. For example, here are demonize, background process, and serve forever functions, which do all this, well, background process and listening forever on a port stuff. But more interesting right now are the menu functions, including the edit, show, and set functions. And to look at the player structure, we could look into the show player func. The cool thing is, it is also used in show team. So every time player information is printed, it will call this function here. Useful to dump some debug info. And in show player func, it looks like there is a parameter RDE that is used to pass in the player address. So let's write a gdbinit script that helps us debugging. First, I copy the default gdbinit to not lose PIDA, and then we set the follow fork mode to child, so gdb will follow the child process upon a fork. Then we set a breakpoint in show player func and use RDI to print some memory. Silent, so we don't see gdb info messages, and continue afterwards, so we just print the memory but don't actually interrupt. And then we can start gdb with -x to specify this gdbinit file, which sets the breakpoint with the commands and runs the binary. Then we can use our other window to connect with netcat to the local port and add a player using a name we can recognize in memory. And when we then show the team, thus call show player func, our breakpoint will be hit and print the memory. And that worked great. Let's add a second player, also with unique data, bbbb as name and 5678 for the stats. Then we select show team and we have a look at the memory. So, we can clearly see four 32-bit integers containing our stats. It was 1234 for the first player and 5678 for the second player. Then we seem to have a fifth value, which is an address or pointer into the heap. In fact, this heap chunk is right after this initial structure, so this is just a string, the name. So to summarize, we have a player structure with four 32-bit integer stats and a pointer to a char array or string, which is also allocated on the heap. And now we come back to our goal. We would like to overwrite an entry in the global offset table. If we could control this pointer somehow and point it into the global offset table, we maybe could use the edit name functionality to write a new name or the address of another function into the global offset table, right? That sounds like a good plan. As the video gets longer than I expected, I will have to split it into two parts. Maybe with the knowledge now of how to debug it and some hints on what we want to do, you could try to do it yourself. And then in a few days, I will tell you how I did it.